speaker, Fedor Bart. So Fedor is actually our international speaker. He's from the Netherlands. He's at Delteris and at the University of Twente. And Fedor is going to talk about models in virtual environments and digital twins.
Yes, thank you for the invitation. Can you see my screen well?
Yes, we can.
Yeah, okay, great. So I wanted to talk a bit to you today about digital twins. So I work at Deltares and TU Delft, actually. So I'm also organizing the workshop with Robert Jan from the TU Twente. And a bit about myself. So I've got a PhD in coastal engineering. I work a lot on visualizations and models at Deltares. Also once escaped from Alcatraz there on the top right. And I discovered an island, a blatant copy of the Chinese from our Palm Island that we built. And also working on some other topics at Deltares, but data science and future modeling are my main topics. And today I want to talk about one of these, let's say, future modeling topics, and that's digital twins. And so that's actually what we call an emerging technology, something that is now becoming popular. And some of you might already have heard of this. And especially in the in Europe, it's now becoming quite popular. And I wanted to discuss a few things. What is a digital twin? A bit about the European initiative, the Digital Twin Earth. And also what makes it different from other things that we already know. And I want to talk to you a bit about why digital twins are popular now. Discussions with you. So a bit about the digital twin. So it's actually a theme or let's say a technology that came over from industry, from building cars, for example. This is one of the earlier pictures that I could find. And then people make a virtual copy of a real world object. And they do that so that they can interact with it, so that they can design it. And that's now a topic that also transformed into our environment. Here you see an example of Dassault. They have a digital twin of planes, for example, and a French company. And also in the Netherlands, we see it used quite a lot. This is one of the tunnels that we are working on in the Netherlands. And then we make a digital copy of that tunnel so that we can test all the things to see if people react to it well when they drive into it virtually. And that we can also test all the, let's say, equipment and the wiring that goes in before we build it. And this is now also something that transformed to the environmental modeling. And this is an example of something that is now called a digital twin, already used to exist, but it's an integration platform of Tigeren, in this case, a Dutch company, where they build the cities and also include interactive flood models, for example. And that is a thing that we now see more and more often. Also, if we look at trends, for example, here you see the Google search trend of how many people are searching for digital twins. Actually looked up that the United States is not yet on a high in the list of people that search for it. But if I look at Europe, then people, then it's becoming quite trendy. That also gives an expectation of how this curve will continue, a prediction, that we now get to a peak of inflated expectations and then a trough of disillusionments. So that's what comes after this. But up to now, we're in we have an innovation trigger, and now we're moving to this peak. And so if you talk about the digital twin, actually it looks quite a lot like things we already know and we've already been using for quite a long time. And so, for example, it looks quite a bit like simulation software, but then typically it's a bit different. For example, simulation, like here, Delft 3D model that we are working on, that's typically passive. So you can start it, you can run it, but you typically don't interact with it while it's running, and it doesn't create, let's say, an immersive environment. It creates charts and maps with these jet color schemes, but it's not, let's say, realistic. And you also typically do it on your own. So that's what makes it different from a digital twin. And something else like a simulator, for example, your flight simulator, that's also not quite a digital twin because it's more single purpose. You can't use it for a helicopter, for example. And it's also quite solitary. You sit there on your own. It is very interactive, And it's also, what also makes a difference, it's not real data. So it's typically, sometimes contains some old scenarios, but it's typically fabricated data used for training purposes. And it's also what you see in, for example, series games. Another thing that, that also has some similarities with digital twins, that typically doesn't contain, let's say, real or realistic physics. It also typically doesn't contain real world or actual or current data. And so those are some things which are almost a digital twin. But if you really want to make a digital twin, at least that is what we found. If we ask people, what do you expect from a digital twin? When we call something a digital twin, then people think it's going to be this. So they think it's going to be photorealistic, interactive. They think they can touch it. They think it has real data and real physics. And now I'm going over all these things to see what we already have as components that are actually going in this direction. But if you zoom out a bit to see what people are actually doing when they call something a digital twin, one thing that is really remarkable is that everybody makes the same picture. Yeah, so before they start building a real digital twin, everybody's making a picture with dark background and light blue lines. So somehow that's also very representative for a digital twin. And in Europe, we actually have a high ambition, you could say a bit too high ambition, and that's called the Project Destination Earth. And that is aimed to make a digital twin of the Earth. And when I first heard about it, I thought, well, let's keep it simple. And but still, this is now, I think, about at least several hundreds of millions. This is the direction going also from the Green Deal and the European Digital Strategy. There's a nice paper in Science about this. And so you can read more about this. But this is the direction we're going. And they actually also made a nice picture with a dark blue background and some lights. And so that fits in quite nice. One of the topics that we are actually already contributing in this context is the precursor digital twin of the ocean. And that is one of the things where we put in our most realistic models, for example, our global tidal model. And so that's actually where we're already actively working towards. And so back to the list of examples. And so if you look at real physics, that's actually something we've been doing for quite a few decades. And so here is an example where we have our old flume, where we invite royalties to really touch the water. And that's where I'm coming to back to that, that we want to, let's say, that is a need that, let's see, many scientists have to really get our tools and models into the hands of the stakeholders. That's also what we use here. This is our latest effort in that direction. Let me just mute it because it has some singing in the background. This is our real physics, our real flume. This what we use to protect new dikes that we want to build in the Netherlands. And this now can generate the biggest artificial waves in the world. So that is, and we learn, we train our models on these data that we generate with these new flumes. And we also use artificial intelligence to detect all the things that are going on in this flume. And then we transform that into our numerical models. And that physics is now becoming a bit, grayish area into data, because these days, as a lot of you probably also do, we're not just simulating physics, but we're also learning from physics. Here you see a deep neural network that we made to learn from, to learn a good downscaling method by feeding it continuously high resolution and low resolution images. And if you do that long enough, it will start learn. If you provide it more context data, it can generate a high resolution image from a low resolution image. And others are doing this as well. For example, Google is working on a hydrological model and it's only feeding it with data. So that is that sort of becomes a grayish area. Also, if you look at the other way, if we look at real data, And for example, this is our new global tidal search model that we use to predict tides and currents in the coast all around the world in a very high resolution. But typically, we don't give this model anymore to people. We just give the data. So that sort of becomes a grayish area. Here you see the search levels that it creates very detailed along the coast. And this is typically one of these components that we put in, for example, into this digital twin of the oceans. Then we provide the storm search and the currents. This is another example of a data set that we make that's also already going. Like, I'm a bit skeptical, but if you zoom out, we're actually already working quite a bit towards a digital twin of the Earth. Here, this was the Aqua Monitor that we created a few years ago. And there we scan the whole world for new land and water. And this is actually where I found this all the way up here. I found this little Chinese island that was one green dot on the top right there, which was a copy of this island down here in Dubai. And this new land and water, and new water here in blue, and you see all these new reservoirs being built. This is actually one of these examples of the direction of this digital twin Earth. We recently also got a new grant from Google for $1 million to work towards this global water watch, where we scan all the reservoirs in the world to get time series and really help people to act to see what everybody's doing, who's keeping the water from who. We're working on that with the World Resource Institute and the Wildlife Foundation. And we're also zooming in all the way here. We're making video maps, for example, in this context. This is what we do for water peace security. And here you see that a new dam is being built and that people are keeping the water from downstream. And then you see people moving here. So that is one of the things that we scan for our Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And so another part is the social part. You really want to focus on decisions. And that is something. To not do it on your own, but to really have people being able to touch the models that we make and to feel them, to work on this together. And the first example is the 3DI model where we worked on to really get it into the hands of the stakeholders. Another example with Robert Jan, who's also here, who I'm organizing the session with, is this virtual river where people can really play with the river and design their own river. And he, Robert Jan, designed this nice sort of game-like environment. And we connected this to this Tigron engine also, so you can have also a 3D view on this monitor. And we connected that to the Delft 3D model to do the real simulations. And so that kind of things, that social aspect is really something that we really consider to really attach it to the real decisions. And you also do that in the United States, for example, here at a nice scale model of the Mississippi, which is sort of a hybrid clone, part physical, but it also has 16 projectors that project the possible futures of the Mississippi Delta. It's really inspirational, I think. And so towards the interactivity, that's also something really important. Here you see the model that we have of the North Sea, where you can really touch the model, so you can put in paint. And you see the paint being picked up by the model, and it starts to flow as you draw it. And then here you see the tide coming from the UK, coming all the way to the Netherlands, and this is transporting this paint with the currents. Another example, I'll go quickly through it, is this Bondi model, where you can sort of hybrid 1D, 2D model, where you have channels. And what you can do then is turn on the rain. So you can put down rain here, really strong rain. And these channels will then try to move this water away. But in this case, it doesn't succeed. So you see these polders slowly filling up with water. If you wait long enough, it will turn blue. And then you see that it's filled up. So then you have a problem. And then you can start designing interactions. So for example, here you can raise the capacity of this pump and you can discuss with the people there if that would be enough to help them solve their problem. So this kind of interactivity is actually something that we made possible together with the systems, the BMI interface where Eric and others are working on. So that really helped us to make these models interactive, so you can touch them while they're running. And that's also a thing that we think is really important towards these digital twins. So we'll have a workshop later with Robert-Jan about how to really design this into activities. And we will also want to gather ideas because like visualization, how to visualize is well defined, but how to interact with models, that's a real new playing field. So we're really interested also in the sharing and gathering ideas with you together. Towards the final two things, photorealistic, and it's also something that people typically expect from a digital twin. Actually, if you ask them what's important, they all expect this, but they don't think it's important. And it's also something that we sometimes do, not always. And so in this example, what we use for the sea level estimates, that we try to convert all the radar images into something that looks like snow and ice and transform it into a video map so people can get a real understanding of a real feeling that Antarctica is really losing ice at the place that's the most important for the Netherlands. And here are some examples of visualizations that we use to warn people to not drive their car through a tunnel in the case of a flood. So we try to show them that is, let's say, not a good idea. And so those kind of visualizations are now much easier because you have photorealistic rendering and physical based rendering and real time ray tracing. So there's really steps going forward that makes it much easier. So back to the digital twin Earth, then you have the integration. There we see a lot of effort, for example, from the Pangeo group, but also then in Europe, where we're trying to build the integration platform. We're also actively looking at what the cloud providers are doing from that concept. So we're the planetary computer from Microsoft, for example, is using a similar approach to what Pangeo and what Fernando talked about, his Jupyter approach. That really gives a new way to work with all this data and integrate it. And Google is, of course, doing the same with the Google Earth Engine. That's what we also use a lot models together. And that's also what you see now, that all this data is moving towards the cloud. It's almost impossible to keep all these data sets local, especially if they start growing in the pace that they're doing now. So then the cloud somehow becomes the default integration engine. And well, that is an interesting development, let's say. But back to why are they now popular? So if I talk to explain this to my colleagues, usually their first reaction, this is just old wine in a new, how do you say that in English, old wine? Something old that we sell as something new. And to a certain extent it is. So you also see that in that people start with making the image. But if you look at it, it also fills in a real need for us scientists to really get our models and tools and data and information really into the hands of the policymakers. And if I look back in my archive and I once made this 3D visualization, like with real stereophotographic visualizations, and it was one of the happiest audience I've ever seen. And so we also really like it ourselves. And it sort of fills in what we say a digital dream. Yes? And that's also what you see with all these dark grounds. This futuristic dream is somehow a need that we have grown. And if that need is fulfilled, we're more likely to appreciate it. And so that is my view on the development of digital twins. And that's where I want to wrap it up.
Thank you so much, Fedor. That was great. And you should have seen the smile on my face. I think this was, you would get a happy audience here as well, if it only was in person. And this actually, the digital twins give really access to what if scenarios, right? You can play with model simulations or with visual imagery. And you make it available for people that are not specifically familiar with models. So I think that's pretty cool.
Yeah, we really see it as a new dissemination format. Although it's hard to, people do expect a lot more from it if you call it this way. So we try to be a bit careful on introducing such a concept.
We have a minute for questions. Does anybody have a question? If so, you can raise your hand and we can unmute you, or you can put your question in the chat.
Yeah, thanks, Gregory. Old wine in new bottles was what I was looking for. In Dutch, it's zakken somehow. Zakken, it's bags somehow. It was from the Bible. I think they still had wine in bags back then. Yeah, so this we use this BMI. That allows you to make to talk to a model while it is in a running state, and that is really the essential, let's say, key part to making something interactive. It also allows you to do many other things. For example, assimilation, for the what we just saw from Paula, like steering a model in the right direction or changing, nudging a bathymetry. That's also assimilating a model is also something you can use BMI as a basic concept for. That's also where we hook on our open data simulation platform.